Hi all, I welcome you all to the next lecture of Introduction to Aerospace Engineering. Today, basically, I am going to cover only two topics. One is the comparison between the airfoil and wing. Then we will go for the Mach number, then critical Mach number and drag divergence Mach number. So these are the two topics that we are going to cover today. So already I given you an idea of airfoil, right? What is an airfoil? So the basic general definition of airfoil says that the airfoil is a specially designed shape which when kept at appropriate angle of attack used to generate a lift. So airfoil is designed to get a normal reaction which is called the lift. So if we look at the shape of airfoil, it usually we draw in this way. This is the airfoil. Basically, so if we draw like this, this is an airfoil. So airfoil, basically if we look at the airfoil, we will getting only these shapes. It will not having any kind of span. So airfoil will not have a span, only this cross section that you are seeing is called airfoil. So flow around it will be two dimensional in nature. So when flow is two dimensional nature, we will be only bothering about the flow in 2D. Third dimension will be having infinite length. So we can say the airfoil will have infinite span, which is not possible, means a reality. So when we're doing the analysis, right, we usually consider this as a two-dimensional geometry, and flow around the airfoil will be two-dimensional nature. So when we talk about the wing will have certain wingspan. So it will have certain wingspan, but cross section of wing will also be an airfoil. So this is basically a wing, all right, and this is airfoil, right? So wing will have certain wingspan. So wingspan is, this is the wingspan, right? Basically this is known as wingspan, denoted by B, and this is known as chord length, denoted by C. So surface area, if you now need to find out B into C, it is a rectangular wing, right? Wing platform area can be calculated in this way, B into C. So this is a wing. So flow around the wing will be three dimensional nature, because there will be flow around top and bottom surface. Also there will be a span wise flow also existing in the case of a wing. So there's a three dimensional flow geometry right around the wing section. But in the case of airfoil, it has not having span. So it has not having any span, so there is no span wise flow in the case of airfoil. So in the case of airfoil, it will be two dimensional flow. So that's why we say this is a 2D and this is a 3D. Now what is the basic difference between wing and finite? So why we are saying this is infinite? Because span, basically we are not concerning span is having no very infinite length. So if we differentiate between these two, we can say, like, first airfoil is a infinite wing. We can say infinite wing. Why we are saying infinite wing? It is having a span that is having infinite length, basically, but we do not consider that. We only bother about the two-dimensional flow. And this is a finite wing, so it is having finite wing span. Second, it is 2D. Flow around this is 2D, and flow around wing is 3D, right? This is the first point in this, the second point. And third point, right, usually we consider airfoil as imaginary, right? And this is real, basically. This is a real. This is real flow. Real flow. This is imaginary, right? Imaginary. Fourth point. Basically, flow around the airfoil when we are doing the analysis, we always consider ideal flow, right? Ideal flow condition. Ideal flow condition. But in the case of wing, when we are doing the analysis, that is called real flow. Conditions. So these are the four basic difference between a two-dimensional wing and three-dimensional wing, or you can say the airfoil and wing. Infinite wing, it is having infinite wingspan, right? Finite. And one more point you can say, when infinite wingspan is there, aspect ratio will be very, very large in the case of two-dimensional. So it two-dimensional in this airfoil is having larger aspect ratio. It is having a smaller aspect ratio, right? Aspect ratio, smaller aspect ratio is a larger aspect ratio. And it's a 2D, it's a 3D, imaginary, real, and flow around this basically in the case of analysis. When we are doing the analysis, flow conditions will be ideal in the case of two-dimensional wing, or you can say airfoil. If it is a three-dimensional wing, if when we are talking about wing flow conditions will be real in this case. So that is the basic difference between, you know, airfoil and wing. There's a one point, you know, between these two that's been covered here. So apart from that, let first we cover the Mach number concept, then we return back again to the wing and section. So first we'll start with the Mach number. Mach number, usually we denote this Mach number by capital M. So Mach number we define like, it is a ratio of local speed of any object, let's suppose this is an object which is moving here in this fluid domain, local speed of this object divided by the speed of sound, or you can say local speed of sound, right, at that particular domain. Whatever the temperature is there, based on that you find out the speed. So it is denoted by the local speed of the object to the speed of sound. So in a very simple way, you can say M is equal to local speed of an object is capital V and speed of sound is A. So this ratio is known as Mach number. Alright, so based on the speed, you can classify the object as a subsonic object, a supersonic object, or hypersonic object. If my Mach number is less than 1, it is a subsonic flight vehicle. If my Mach number is exactly equal to 1, I can say sonic vehicle. And if the Mach number is greater than 1.3, I can say it is a supersonic vehicle. If my Mach number is going greater than 5, I will say there is a hypersonic flight vehicle. Right, so like that we can do, and based on this Mach number we can even divide the flow subsonic, supersonic, hypersonic flows, right, based on their speed. So speed for flow basically we define in velocity, but when we are going at a velocity higher than 100 meter per second, then a lot of compressibility effects will come. When compressibility comes into the picture, it is a very convenient way to express the speed of the flow in the terms of Mach number. So always we say Mach 2 flow, Mach 3 flow, Mach 4 flow. Based on that, we, you know, differentiate the different regions of flow. So this is the Mach number, right? Let's go for the second, that is called critical Mach number. So critical Mach number is nothing but it is a local Mach number. Usually we define this in this way. It is a local Mach number at which flow over airfoil first reaches a sonic velocity. So free stream Mach number, you can say it is a free stream Mach number at which flow over an airfoil becomes sonic, at any particular point becomes sonic. That is known as critical Mach number. So as per definition, we can say it is a local Mach number, local flow Mach number at which flow over the airfoil fast reaches the sonic velocity. So let's see, we consider three cases. So first airfoil is something like this, second airfoil is here something like this, and third airfoil is here something like this. So let's suppose local Mach number when it is coming as 0.3, right, and I am considering a point A over this, and same point I will consider here also point A, and here also point A. This point is called location of minimum pressure point. Alright, location of minimum pressure point. If my local Mach number is 0.3, at this point I am getting Mach number is only 0.435. If I am further increasing the local Mach number is around 0.5, I am getting here MA is equal to 0.772. Alright. Similarly, if I further increase this number around 0.61, the moment my Mach number, local Mach number is becoming 0.61, M is equal to 0.61, I am reaching MA is equal to 1. MA is equal to 1. Clear? So, as per the definition says, it is a local Mach number, local flow Mach number at which flow over the airfoil becomes the sonic, right? It's called critical Mach number. So as per these three examples, right, out of these three, this local Mach number M is equal to 0.61 is my critical Mach number basically. critical Mach number. So if I maintain my flow at Mach 0.61, right, I will get the sonic flow at the top surface of the airfoil or whatever selected point which I consider, right, at that point I will have a sonic velocity if my local flow Mach number is maintained at 0.61. So this 0.61 is known as critical Mach number. So critical always talks about it is the Mach number at which flow will become sonic. Keep it very simple. So at Mach 0.61, if I am sending the flow and the flow is getting attached over the surface or the surface of the airfoil, right, the flow geometry becomes the sonic, right, and that is known as critical Mach number. This is the one thing. This every time one flow comes into contact with the airfoil, this condition will exist. Next one is drag divergence Mach number. So drag divergence Mach number. So notation for critical Mach number is M critical MCR. So here we can represent MCR is equal to 0.61. Drag divergence MDD. So this is known as drag divergence Mach number. So we talk about something called drag. So drag is coming. So drag divergence, all of a sudden means drag will diverge. Diverge means it will increase. So it is the Mach number at which there is a sudden increase in drag. How it will happen? So if we draw the variation of local Mach number here and drag over here, initially drag will be something called up to critical Mach number, that is 0.61. This is subsonic zone. Drag will be almost linear. Once you cross this limit, this is actually M critical, right? If you cross this point, there will be sudden increase in drag. So flow geometry will become like this. So the moment it is started, this point is M drag divergence Mach number, right? And this wire separation happened here. This point is M is equal to 1. M is equal to 1. This location is M is equal to 1. So this point is drag divergence Mach number. So drag divergence Mach number is the local Mach number at which drag increases abruptly. That is known as drag divergence Mach number, and it will be always less than 1, right? 1 is somewhere here. So drag divergence Mach number will lie between 0.7 to 0.9, somewhere some value will lie. That at that Mach number there will be a sudden increase in drag, and that Mach number is known as drag divergence Mach number. So these are the basically three Mach numbers that you are going to use in finding out the performance parameters. What is critical Mach number? So critical Mach number will tell you the initiation of the drag point, right? Immediately after that, drag divergence Mach number will come. So drag divergence Mach number, your drag will increase just abruptly. All of a sudden there is increase in drag, right? That's not drag divergence Mach number. This is regarding the Mach number, and let's again return back to the airfoil. So this, I don't think so, these here some problem will be there. These are very basic fundamental about the drag divergence Mach number. So now as already I said, if I draw CL versus alpha, this is CL and this is versus alpha. This is basically a symmetrical airfoil. If I want to go for unsymmetrical, unsymmetrical will not start from zero. It will be starting from negative side and will go like the higher end stall like this. So this is alpha stall, this is for symmetrical, right? And this is basically alpha stall for cambered. So if you compare CL max also, CL max will be higher in the case of CL max 2, and as this is CL max 1. So 1 is your basically symmetric, right? And 2 is cambered, and these are the stalling point. So we are comparing, you know, symmetrical airfoil with unsymmetrical airfoil, and somebody asks you what are the basic differences. First, if basic difference, you can say in symmetrical airfoil camber is zero. When camber is going to be zero, that means your lift distribution that you are talking about will be starting from zero angle of attack. So if my angle of attack is zero, I will not have any kind of unbalanced potential to generate the lift, right? So mean camber line, chord line, basically coincide in the case of asymmetric airfoil. But in unsymmetrical airfoil or camber airfoil, there will be a definitive difference between mean camber line and chord line. So it will have certain camber. So when camber is present, it is already having some inbuilt angle, right, which will produce the lift even at 0 degree angle of attack, and that lift will be slightly inward, inward angle. So angle will be negative. So that is called zero lift angle of attack. So I clearly mentioned in the airfoil characteristics that value is fixed between -2 to -3. Any value will be there that is fixed by the design of the airfoil. So it is already having inbuilt zero lift angle of attack. So even we are orienting unsymmetric airfoil at zero angle of attack, it will generate the lift. That's why you see here at 0 degree angle of attack, we are having certain lift. So basic difference is between because of that camber line and chord line. All right. And when we talking about aerodynamic center and center of pressure, right, as in the case of symmetric airfoil, mean camber line, chord line, both are lying on the same point, right? So that means your aerodynamic center and center of pressure will be lying on the same line. That doesn't mean they will coincide, right? So if you want to draw the location of aerodynamic center of pressure in symmetric airfoil or whatever camber airfoil, so camber airfoil is a movable point, but in symmetric airfoil it will be exactly over this line. So this is the chord line in the case of symmetric airfoil. I assume this is symmetric airfoil. So first point is, this point is called aerodynamic center and this point is called center of pressure. So in the case of symmetric airfoil, aerodynamic center and center of pressure will lie on the same line, that is called chord line. All right. And this is fixed point in the case of symmetric airfoil. So lift basically will generate here and drag will also be acting at the center of pressure. All right. But on the aerodynamic center, there will be no lift, no drag, right? Basically there will be undesirable movement, but because of the generation of this lift, that movement will get nullified. So when we are keeping your airfoil at 0 degree angle of attack, it will not generate any kind of undesirable movement because of these forces acting over this point, the movement which was acting here, which was fixed basically, that's not going to vary. The fixed movement that will get nullified because of this effect. All right. So this is the basic difference between aerodynamic center and center of pressure in the case of symmetric airfoil. In symmetric airfoil, that will always lie on the chord line. But if it is an unsymmetric airfoil, then center of pressure is not a fixed point. It will move, right, as per the angle of attack. Keep in mind. So as it moves with the angle of attack, the lift value will be higher compared to the symmetric airfoil. So first difference based on the mean camber line and chord line, you can say. Second point, you can talk about the stalling angle. So stalling will be much earlier in the case of camber airfoil compared to the symmetric airfoil, but for the same speed, the lift generated on the camber airfoil will be higher than the symmetric airfoil, right? You can look at here. So even though stalling is happening much earlier compared to the symmetric airfoil, but lift generated is higher compared to the symmetric airfoil. Similarly, you can say the lift curve slope, as a lift is higher, lift curve slope, you can compare. So lift curve slope here is A and here this is A naught. So lift curve slope in camber airfoil is higher compared to the symmetric airfoil, like that you can say. Third point you can include about the zero lift angle of attack. Zero lift angle of attack in the case of symmetric airfoil is zero, but in unsymmetric airfoil already it is having zero lift angle of attack. Because of that, it is already generating some lift at 0 degree angle of attack. Like that you can differentiate, right? But nowhere, keep in mind, nowhere center of pressure and aerodynamic center will coincide. That condition will not happen anywhere. They will be lying at certain distance, right? But sometimes they will be lying on chord line, and sometimes aerodynamic center is fixed, that will always be lying on chord line, but center of pressure will move, right, based on the angle of attack. And the moment about center of pressure is always zero, right? Whatever it is moving on top or going down, moment about this point will be zero. That's why we are saying all aerodynamic forces used to be acting on this point. There is no desirable moment. So then we relate A and A naught, right, to a certain relation, that was A is equal to A naught upon 1 plus A naught upon pi into A into aspect ratio. So this relation we got, right? If we want to relate the lift curve slope for unsymmetric airfoil A with A naught divided by 1 plus A naught divided by pi E aspect ratio. So aspect ratio, we know, being span divided by chord length is known as aspect ratio. So by using this relation, I can find out the elliptical slope for either 2D or 3D. But a lot of experiments have been done, and we have found that usually this A0 value will be 2 times of pi, this per radian or per degree you can convert, right? So experiments have shown that the elliptical slope for symmetric airfoil will be approximately equal to 2 times of pi, right? That is usual way, right? But we cannot assume. In the problem, they will give you the elliptical slope for 2D, and by using that, you can find out the elliptical slope for the unsymmetric airfoil. So this is the basic thing regarding the airfoil. So I will solve one problem today, and you try some more problems from the introduction to flight by John D. Anderson. So I will give only one problem. With that, I will close the today's discussion. Time is 20, so 5 more minutes. So take the problem. Consider a straight wing with aspect ratio 6, assuming no speed flow. Calculate the lift coefficient at an angle of attack of 6 degree for the wing. The wing span efficiency factor is 0.95, and a two-dimensional lift curve slope is 0.105 for a degree, comma, zero lift angle of attack for the airfoil is minus 2.2 degree. So these are the things given, and you need to find out basically the lift coefficient at an angle of attack 6 degree. So what is given basically? Excel, I repeat again, note it down. Consider a straight wing with aspect ratio 6, assuming low speed flow. Calculate the lift coefficient at an angle of attack 6 degree for the wing. The wing span efficiency factor is 0.95, full stop. Two dimensional lift curve slope is 0.105 per degree, and zero lift angle of attack is minus 2.2 degree, right? And you need to find out the CL. So problem, what is given? So given is a straight wing. It is a straight wing, right? With aspect ratio which is given as 6, alright, calculate the lift. We need to find out the CL, right? That need to be calculated at an angle of attack 6 degree, alright, for the wing efficiency factor or Ostwald efficiency factor, that is E, which is given as 0.95, alright, two dimensional lift curve slope, that is nothing but A naught, which is given as 0.105 per degree, which is given here, and alpha L is equal to 0 is given minus 2.2 degree. So these are all given data, and we need to find out this CL. So how to proceed to solve this problem? We know that CL is nothing but A into alpha effective. This is the formula that we have seen. This is nothing but alpha minus alpha L is equal to 0. So out of this, we know alpha, we know alpha L not value, but we don't know the A. So A need to be calculated, right? So for that, I know this formula. A is equal to A naught divided by 1 plus A naught upon pi E into aspect ratio. So this is the formula that I will use. So before doing so, first I will write, because this pi is there in radian, so I need to convert this into radian. So this is given per degree, so per degree can be converted into radian as 180 divided by pi. If you multiply 180 and divide by pi, you will get per radian. This coming 6.02 per radian. Once you get the value of A naught in per radian, substitute here. So the moment you substitute here, it's coming 6.02, 1 plus 6.02 divided by pi into E is 0.95 into aspect ratio is 6. Just put in a calculator and get the value. So this value is coming around 4.51 per radian. So convert that into degree by into pi divided by 180, multiply by pi divided by 180, it is coming around 0.079 per degree, Why do we are saying this? Because here we will put the value in degree. Alpha is in degree and this alpha L naught is in degree. So we need to convert A is also in per degree. So we got the A 0.079 per degree. Now we can find out our CL. So CL is equal to 0.079, alpha is 6, right, minus 2.2, right. You solve this, you will get this CL. So CL is coming around 0.648. So this is the coefficient of lift generated from this file for the given data. Clear? So like that you can solve this kind of problems may be asked. This is very simple problem, right? A naught is given, A can be calculated. Sometimes they will give you A and they may find out to calculate A naught. So like that you can make a calculations for the numerical problem. So with this I am closing the today's discussion. Today we have covered the difference between the wing or airfoil, or you can say two dimensional or three dimensional wing or finite or infinite wing. All right, and then we have seen the Mach number, critical Mach number, and drag dimensions Mach number, and we have solved one problems over this. With this I am closing today's discussion. In the next class when you come here, right, we will be deriving expression for lift and drag coefficient using the dimensional analysis. So thank you for your patience today. Have a nice day. Good day.